every acupuncturist will tell you that the body is a small magnet. We have currents flowing through us, the meridians. And the earth is a big magnet. It has currents flowing through it, the meridians. And when you put your small magnet down that close to the big magnet, there's an attunement that happens. There's a magnetic change that takes place. And of course, the little magnet follows the big magnet. And we earth ourselves, we ground ourselves. There's also something very interesting about bowing that I think many of you, judging by the feeling that I was getting as I grabbed the opportunity to bow to each of you, that the only time that we have our heart and our head on the same level is when? At night, when we're asleep. When we consciously put head and heart on the same level and we're awake, things change. At night, dreams happen. When we're bowing, karmic seeds come back to mind. And it's a wonderful chance to take a big, deep bath in all the mistakes you've made since you were first aware. And that's a good thing. Many people report when they bow, even the very first time, bowing experience, that it's like stepping back into your tape library of mistakes and disasters and some joys, some happy memories, and they just wash, they wash up. And it's very much like cleaning your closet when you bow. So what do you do with that, all that? What we practiced just now was the outside form of a particular, I mean, everyone was bowing each in their own different way, and be amazed how many varieties of bowing there. You only get to see the person in front of you, right? Well, I get to see all of you. Everyone has their own particular take on the bowing experience. And so that's the form. But inside, what's going on inside? Can we learn to bow inside? How do we deal with all those images that keep rolling up? Or not necessarily. Sometimes you bow, it's very blissful. You feel one with the earth, with the stars, indeed, because we're not different from the stars. So I'm sure the inner experience is different as well as the outer experience. But I wanted to share with you what I did when I bowed. And I'll do it in English. In the every step, every bow, one, two, three, bow, one, two, three, bow. Every bow was accompanied by a line, a verse from a sutra, from the Buddha's words. And in Chinese, it goes, Wang Shi So Zao Zhu E Ye, Jie You Wu Shi Tan Chen Chi, Cong Shen Yu Yi Zhi So Sheng, Yi Qie Wo Jin Jie Chan Hui. For all the harmful things I've done with my body, mouth, and mind, from beginningless greed, anger and stupidity, through lifetimes without number to this very day, I now repent and I vow to change entirely. For the good, we hope. For all the harmful things I've done with body, mouth, and mind, from beginningless greed, anger, and delusion or wrong views, stupidity, through lifetimes without number, to this very thought, I now repent and I vow to change entirely. So it's a prayer for renewal. It's not flagellation. It's not, you know, beating yourself up. But it's because of beginningless greed, anger, and delusion that we're, because we are sentient creatures, we have those things. We're not yet awake. So you say, I want to change that. I'm really aware of what I did. So that's the inner bowing that takes place. And I wanted to ask, is Neil, are you with the, who's on the computer duty? Ken, or I'm not sure who's the computer walla. We need to, the Mac walla. Because I want you to bring up, it says, Samantabhadra's repentance verse. And we'll take a minute, and while Neil's getting that together, I'm going to tune here. From beginningless greed, anger and stupidity, through lifetimes without number, to this very day, I now repent and I vow to change entirely. You're welcome to join if you care to. Nobody's paying attention. Nobody's counting. As they say, it'll do you no harm. For all the harmful things I've done, with my body, speech, and mind, from beginningless greed, anger, and stupidity, through lifetimes without number, to this very day, I now repent and I bow, little high, sorry, to change entirely. For all the harmful things I've done, with my body, speech, and mind, from beginningless greed, anger, and stupidity, through lifetimes without number, to this very day, I now repent and I bow to change entirely. I now repent and I bow to change entirely. So that's the English translation of the repentance verse that belongs to a bodhisattva named Samantabhadra. And Samantabhadra is everywhere good, everywhere wholesome, so everywhere virtuous. We've had this experience tonight. Goodness, anything I can say is superfluous, actually. I would like to, Neil, can we drop that off? And let's see. Maybe just, here's what I'd like to do. As I was, as I say, getting the chance to bow to each of you, when Auntie came around, when your mom came around, chance to bow to her. Wow, that's profound. So as I was watching everybody, I was thinking all the different experiences you were having, and I'm sure, and what a thrill to be able to find more people who've had that experience. There aren't many, you know, who would imagine bowing to the ground. Whatever for, isn't that dirty? You know, it's like people have all kinds of reactions to that. And so one of the one of the most profound, long-lasting results of doing that is the connection you make to the earth. You know, I mean, we mostly touch it only with that, or when we sleep flat. So how funny, you know, only this tiny bit of area actually touches the earth unless you meditate. If you meditate, then you've got the bottom of your thighs. But we pretty much relate to the earth from about, 4 feet, 5 feet, 6 feet up. You know, if you're Yao Ming, you add a foot, but that's all right. Jeremy Lin. He's only what, 6'2", I think. Yeah. But you get the point. How strange, you know, and yet we go back to it, we came from it, we go back to it, as did everyone. Nobody doesn't go back to the earth. You know, the earth is here to eat our corpses, said a poet. Wow. So what do? Mostly we just, if you're a human being, if you're that species, mostly you consume it. We consume the earth, and then it consumes us in turn. And rarely do we get a chance to say thank you. But it sustains us. I mean, we do eat food that comes out of factories, it's true. The American diet, a lot of the things we eat never saw the earth. You know, they're products of factories. But once we get away from that consumption, then we realize that we're eating the earth. Our bodies are earth. We are it. It is us. So I find that when I give kids the chance to express gratitude for the earth, they mostly just immediately get it. You know, nobody invites the adults to, unless you're a farmer like Pancho, and teaching us how to get back to the earth and appreciate it. Adi Elijah, who only eats local, he doesn't even talk about, you know, connecting. So what I wanted to do is invite you all to join me in saying thank you to the earth. Here we go. So the chorus goes like this. Thank you to the universe. Thank you to the earth and sky. I may not repay my parents' kindness, but every day I try. Okay, can you do that? Thank you to the universe. Thank you to the earth and sky. I may not repay my parents' kindness, but every day I try. Good, okay, you got it. People ask me, what did you get from your meditation? Are you enlightened? Have you ended your frustration? The wise men and women who woke up, all those I reviewed, say the highest state is a wish to repay a heart of gratitude. Here we go, your part. Thank you to the universe. Thank you to the earth and sky. I may not repay my parents' kindness, but every day I try. How many years did I waste waiting for my prize? For my ship to finally come in, for my payoff to arrive. But joy comes not from getting, but from giving it all away. Sages say, once you see the Tao, you feel a wish to repay. Here we go. Thank you to the universe. Thank you to the earth and sky. I may not repay my parents' kindness, but every day I try. Teacher's kindness. I may not repay my teacher's kindness, but every day I try. The planet's kindness. I may not repay the planet's kindness, but every day I try. Parents' kindness. I may not repay my parents' kindness, but every day I try. So that comes up when you're bowing. And that's completely natural.
It'd be great if you use this, but don't point it to that side.
Say what?
It'd be great if you use this, but don't point it.
It'd be great if you use this, but don't.
I got the first part.
Don't point it over there, because it'll interfere.
It'll interfere. Got it. Okay. Okay, we're ready. Neil is going to help me out. It's 9:05. How about that? I'll compress my talk into... All right, where's my...
Give you an idea of how technologically savvy your Rev Heng Sure is. He doesn't need a clicker. He's using his iPhone.
No connection available. Ah, I told you. Ah, there we go. When the grid goes down, what you gonna do? Okay. Actually, that's interesting. Neil took us right to the sutra. Actually, I think I want the keynote first, and then we'll go back to the sutra. So it's right in the middle. There you go. Okay. And if you click the start, he knows Max. Great. Okay. So, Bodhisattva path practices and vows. I wanted people to use this word with authority. Bodhisattva. Everybody say Bodhisattva.
Bodhisattva.
Okay, Bodhi, the same root as Buddha, right? To awaken, to wake up, like waking up in the morning, you know, waking up from sleep. And Sattva, being, right? Bodhisattva. People get their Sanskrit and they go, Bodhisattva. You know, and you can do it, Bodhisattva. But it's just, you know, Buddha. It's Bodhi, Americanize it, Bodhisattva, right? Bodhisattva. So you can say it. It awakened being, and so it's an awakened being, but it's also one who awakens other beings. So it has both sides. The Bodhisattva is someone who himself, herself is awake, but takes that as an incomplete state until all beings are awake. Because what makes a bodhisattva is having transformed that small ego that grows up thinking it's broken from everything. And that's a lot of hard work to do. You bow the small self away. Back, you give the small self away. You design website the small self away, you know. You volunteer the small, you surrender the small self away. So listening to Jayesh Bhai before the show, we talked about surrender. And it's a great gift of women, that ability to surrender. And you can surrender yourself away into a state of finding the connection with the bigger self, which is everybody. Lo and behold, when you empty out, it's not that there's nothing there, you find everything and the connection. You realize, oh, you know, all that time I thought that I stopped with my skin, that was a wrong view. You know, that was the partial, I wasn't awake yet. So, but that's hard work. It's because everything in the world, grab for all the gusto you can get, have another bud. You know, that it's there to keep us locked in to this consuming thing, you know. So the Bodhisattva has done that work, and now has awakened. What did they wake up from? What? From the Buddha's vision, sentient beings are all asleep with our eyes open. Right. Our eyes are open, but we're actually asleep. He said we're born drunk and dying in a dream, and that's the most, you know. How well I remember my days of being born drunk and dying in a dream. We believe that we're separate. And we struggle for the ego, for the benefits, for wealth, sex, fame, food, and comfort. That's the five desires. And then we pass on without a trace, still dreaming. You know, that's the story of me. You know. The Bodhisattva wakes up to the reality of emptiness and impermanence. And not self at the heart of all things. This is called the three seals of Dharma. So all conditioned things, from that wax candle to the bodies that we're sitting in right now, are empty, not to say empty, it's clearly it's not, but ultimately there's no single thing here which is a permanent entity. It's all components. We're all component parts entirely. And they don't stick together forever. They come together and they go away. You know, none of us look like we did when we were 3, or the way we will when we're 80. You know. So, and finally, if you say, what is ultimately the intrinsic essence of conditioned dharmas? There's not self. There's no self there. And once you recognize that that is the nature of all things, it's like, what's the point of grabbing onto it and trying to make it last when it's going to go? It passes through. So it's those are the three seals of the Dharma. And I prepared a whole bunch of slides that talk about the Bodhisattva paradigm from one tradition called the Mahayana, the Chinese tradition, which is what I have studied. And I think given the time, probably I would like to move on through this very quickly just to give you a sense of it. And if it's a teaser, then I'm afraid that's all we really want to do tonight. But there are particularly 4 bodhisattvas that the Mahayana pays attention to. Guan Shi Yin is Avalokiteshvara, the bodhisattva of compassion. Earth Treasury is Shirigarbha, bodhisattva. Manjushri is great wisdom. Samantabhadra is great vows, great practices, that is, great practices. So great compassion, great vows, great wisdom, and great practices. Those are the 4 major bodhisattvas that people talk about. And this is fascinating. This is a tapestry discovered at Dunhuang out in Xinjiang province. It's a library with cave paintings. Dunhuang is the home of those famous flying bodhisattvas that you see, you know, the apsaras. They look like they're aerodynamically correct, you know, their clothes are just as they would be if they were flying down. And this was a tapestry from the librarian's wall. This is a wall poster from the Tang Dynasty, right? The librarian at Dunhuang had an image of Avalokiteshvara with 1,000 hands, and each hand has an eye in the palm, and also 11 heads and 42 hands with implements in it, surrounded by these other bodhisattvas. So this is a Tang Dynasty wall poster, 10th century wall poster, from the library at Dunhuang. How fascinating. So this is how people before television imagined bodhisattvas look like. Right? So that's interesting. So these are called celestial bodhisattvas. That is to say, these are the devotional beings, the focus of devotion. When people want to imagine a bodhisattva, this is what they report. This is a stained glass bodhisattva from Berkeley Buddhist Monastery. This is a jack-o'-lantern bodhisattva from Halloween in Berkeley, California, carved right onto a pumpkin. How about that? This is, which bodhisattva is this? First of all, anybody recognize who this is? Who is it? Yeah, and from where? Where? Close, close, but not. You're warm. Barcelona, give you a hint. Oh. Montserrat. This is the Black Madonna of Montserrat. And when I went in front of her, I thought, that's Guan Yin Bodhisattva, man. There's no doubt in my mind that that is Guan Yin. Because Guan Yin often appears with a baby, with not a baby, a youth. His name is Sudana. And Guan Yin holds a wish-fulfilling pearl. The wall hanging had one. And the wish-fulfilling pearl has a hole in it for a flower, and there it was, Guan Yin's willow branch that she sprinkles sweet dew. It's every bit you know, the iconography of Guanyin Bodhisattva. Richard should pay close attention here. This is fascinating. I mean, I'm sure he could give us the whole, you know, history of this. But if this image did not exist, we would have to invent her. The conclusion is not, I mean, who got it first? That's not useful. The useful conclusion is, how interesting, when humanity reaches for compassion, this is what we come up with. Whether it's Roman Catholic, or Indian, or Chinese, or American. We imagine compassion looking like this. Female, connected, nurturing, just that look, you know. Now, there's a whole story about this. They think the Apostle Paul actually carved this. And it was not black to begin with, it was wooden to begin with, but. So, okay, that's a familiar image. We've seen that one, right? We've seen that one. Yep, try it again. That one, but have we seen this one? Guanyin Bodhisattva. So, we don't care who got it first, but it's interesting that this is how compassion appears. Okay, now, people in my community, we have a lot of, I don't want to say, superstition is a hard word, but there's lots of people in our community, the Chinese and Vietnamese, Mahayana, who love finding magic in clouds, and, you know, bodhisattvas in toast, you know, pieces of toast, you know, door screens and things. Just, that's the, you know, it's popular religion. But every now and then, you see one. And Guanyin Bodhisattva, of all the four of them, is the one who appears. She manifests. Guanyin will show up. And people have had personal experiences with Guanyin Bodhisattva. So this was taken 3 years ago over Potala Mountain in the East China Sea. And that's a remarkable, this is the mountain that where Guanyin is supposed to live. And when I showed this, people actually got up and bowed to the screen. It's like, that's an interesting, so lots of images. So anyway, we're going through this. Here's another famous Guanyin image. At ease, Avalokita. Here Guanyin is a male with a mustache. This one is in Australia. Guanyin has many different names. She appears as the white-robed maiden, like that. So anyway, I'm going to ask, at this point, ask Neil to take us to a sutra. I'll let you take over from here. He knows how to do it. It's the nicest writer file. Yeah, there we are. Good. Okay. Now, here's what I would like to do. I thought, instead of hearing me talk about bodhisattvas and compassion, how nice it would be, and that you had the experience of bowing, is the perfect intro to this. I thought, take everybody right to the source. And I have never done this on a Wednesday night. This is the first time. But Nipun invited me to show folks the real thing. This is a sutra. It's called a flower garland, the Avatamsaka Sutra. Mahavaipulya Buddha Avatamsaka Sutra. And this is the sutra that talks about the Bodhisattva path. And it's a handbook. It tells you how. It says, do this and do this, and your Bodhisattva practices will come to fruition. It's given, I mean, it could be a PDF doc file for under Bodhisattva how to, you know. that's where this should be filed. And of all the, this is the sutra that I bowed to for 2.5 years, carried on my back, and recited the name of it with every single bow, and copied it out, and we're currently translating it. But this is my favorite passage from the whole sutra. And I'll tell you where this comes. This comes at the very, very end of the sutra. It's a 40-chapter sutra. This is chapter 40. And there are, in this chapter, Samantabhadra, Bodhisattva, explains to a young man, Sudana, how to cultivate the Bodhisattva path, how to do the practices. And it's a how-to, and it's the final answer. Now, the young man, Sudana, has now visited 52 teachers. And each teacher he asks, he says, how do I cultivate the Bodhisattva path? How do I practice Bodhisattva practices? Please teach me, he says, to 52 teachers. And each teacher, without exception, says back to him, young man, have you made the great Bodhi resolve? He says, the Bodhicitta, have you brought forth the great Bodhicitta? And Sudana says, yes, I have. I've done that. I had that thought that I wanted to maximize my potential for wisdom and compassion. I wanted to become the best possible person I could be. And the teacher goes, good. Okay, let me teach you. You ready? Here we go. And they roll up their sleeves and they teach them the next practice. 53 times. That's the story. It's an epic literature. If anybody is studied lit crit, this is an epic. It's wonderful. It's profound. It's Mahayana Buddhism's epic. So, the last one is Samantabhadra, and he tells Sudana, finally answers his question. He says, here's what you do. You do 10 things. This is number 9. The 10 are, he says, let me do it the way we do it in the morning. Okay, here's how we do it. We chant it, we go. First is to worship and respect all Buddhas. Second is to make praises to the thus come one. Third is to practice profoundly the giving of offerings. Fourth, to repent and reform all karmic hindrance. Fifth, to rejoice in merit and virtue. Sixth is to request that the Dharma wheel be turned. Seventh, request that the Buddhas remain in the world. Eight is to follow the Buddha's teaching always. Ninth is to constantly accord with all living beings. Tenth, to transfer all merit and virtue universally. Homage all Buddhas of the 10 quarters and 3 times. All bodhisattvas, mahasattvas, mahaprajnaparamita. All beings of the 4 births in the 9 worldly realms. May they together gain the secret door of the flower store. All souls suffering in the 3 paths below, may they enter one and all by Rochana's nature sea. So that's the 10 vows of Samantabhadra that we do every morning. This is number 9, always accord to living beings. So, Neil, I'm going to ask you to scroll. Now, anybody who would like to, if you'd like to recite with me, just for fun, try to taste it. If this is not something you're interested in doing or feel uncomfortable, please do not feel, again, nobody's noticing, nobody's keeping track, all right? But if you would like to, I'm going to put my palms together and recite Samantabhadra Bodhisattvas. Could you hand me the folder that's under that flap, the brown folder? That's the one. Thank you. I'm going to give myself a crick in the neck if I try to read it from there, so I'm going to read it from here. Okay, if you'd like to join me, let's read together. Vow number 9, always accord with living beings. Again, good man, and this is, by, mind you, this is gender non-specific. So good person, good woman. Together, again, good man, I'll tell you about constantly according with all living beings. Throughout oceans of Buddha lands in the 10 directions, to the ends of the Dharma realm and the realm of space, there are many kinds of living beings. That is to say, those born from eggs, womb-born, moisture-born, transformationally born, and beings who live in different elements, depending on earth, water, fire, and air. Some soar in space, others cling to plants, some perch in forests. This includes all the many species and races with their diverse bodies, shapes, faces, lifespans, families, names, and natures. This includes their many varieties of knowledge and outlooks, their various wishes and joys, their thoughts and deeds, and their many different manners, costumes, and diets. It includes beings who dwell in villages, towns, cities, and palaces, as well as gods, dragons, and the others of the Eightfold Pantheon, humans and non-humans alike. Also, there are footless beings, beings with 2 feet, 4 feet, and many feet. There are beings with form and without form, with thought and without thought, and those neither entirely with thought nor entirely without thought. I will accord with and take care of all these many kinds of beings, providing them all manner of services and offerings. I will treat them with the same respect I show my parents, teachers, elders, arhats, and even thus come ones, serving them all equally without any differences. I will be a good doctor for the sick and suffering. I will lead those who have lost their way to the right road. I will be a bright light for those in the dark night and will lead the poor and destitute to discover hidden treasures. Okay, pause. Absorb all that. Okay. Okay, here we go. Together. If a bodhisattva accords with living beings, then she accords with and makes offerings to all Buddhas. If she can honor and serve living beings, then she honors and serves the thus come ones. If she makes living beings happy, then this is making all Tathagatas happy. Why is this? Because the heart of great compassion is the essence of all Buddhas, Tathagatas, thus come ones. Because of living beings, great compassion comes forth. From great compassion, the Bodhi mind is born. And because of their Bodhi mind, Buddhas accomplish equal and proper enlightenment. Pause. Now we get an image. Together, here we go. It is like a great king of trees growing amid the rocks and sand of a barren wilderness. When the roots get water, the branches and leaves flourish, and the flowers and fruits are abundant. The regal Bodhi tree, growing in the wilderness of birth and death, is the same. All living beings are its roots. All Buddhas and Bodhisattvas are its flowers and fruits. By benefiting all living beings with the water of great compassion, one can realize the flowers and fruits of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas' wisdom. Why is this? If bodhisattvas benefit all beings with the water of great compassion, they can obtain anuttara samyak sambodhi. Therefore, bodhi belongs to living beings. If there were no living beings, bodhisattvas could not achieve unsurpassed proper enlightenment. Good man, woman. That's it. Good. Okay, I have another paragraph. That's it, right? Okay, good. All right. Well done. Thank you. How did that taste? Isn't that interesting? An English language Mahayana Sutra translated through Chinese from Sanskrit. So Sanskrit, Chinese. Now it's in English. All right, what did we just read? This is, we're reading the words of a Bodhisattva Mahasattva Samantabhadra, and he's speaking for the Buddha, and he's talking, it's a conversation. Good man who he's talking to is Sudana, the student, but it could be any one of us, certainly not gender specific. And he says, here's how you accord with living beings. And then he gives this huge, long list of all the different kinds of living beings. Obviously, nobody's left out. Not only are no humans left out, even if they vote for Mitt Romney, never mind, sorry, never mind. We will include everyone. But other species are included, right? The insects, right? Those beings unborn, no matter where they live, no matter what they eat, no matter how they vote, no matter what language they speak, right? Even the gods, the dragons, and the spiritual animals of the pantheon. Footless beings, worms, snakes, beings with 2 feet, bipeds, right? Quadrupeds, 4 feet, many feet, millipedes, centipedes, spiders. So beings with form and without form. So all these gods are included, you know, ghosts are included. So then after that long list, he says, here's the turning point. Says, and the Samantabhadra is speaking as if giving voice to the Bodhisattva's vow. And vows are big for Bodhisattvas. He says, I will accord with and take care of all these many kinds of beings, providing them with all manner of service space offerings. No, that's not what he said. something like that, right? I will treat them with the same respect I show who? My parents, my teachers, elders, arhats, even the Tathagata, the Buddha himself. Serving them all equally without difference. So you serve a child in the streets of Ahmedabad the same way you serve the Buddha, the same way you serve your parents, no different. You serve your mom the same way you serve the Buddha, no different. I will, he's specific, I will be a good doctor for the sick and suffering. I will lead those who have lost their way to the right road, be a guide. I will be a bright light for those in the dark night, literally or figuratively. And I will lead the poor and destitute to discover hidden treasures. And he's not talking about money. Right? Spiritual wealth. Those poor and destitute spiritual souls lost in the marketplace. Right? Okay, that's the vow. And then, he says, what happens when you do this? If a bodhisattva accords with living beings, then he accords with and makes offerings to all Buddhas. Living beings here means that whole list, right? It means also your own next bad thought. It's talking about inner living beings. My jealousy, my greed, my anger, my low self-esteem, my depression, my fears, right? Those are the living beings who the Bodhisattva is working to serve, to lead them from the darkness to the light. Okay. If a bodhisattva accords with living beings, then she accords with and makes offerings to all Buddhas. If she can honor and serve, service space, all living beings, then she honors and serves the Tathagatas. If she makes living beings happy, then she is making all thus come ones, Tathagatas, happy. Why? Right? What's the connection? These sutras are so satisfying because it's like, yeah, I wanted to know why too. Why is that? Thank you for asking. Because the heart of great compassion is the essence of all Buddhas, Tathagatas. That's how important this losing of self in surrender is. Because of living beings, great compassion comes forth. From great compassion, the Bodhi mind is born, Sudana's question. And because of the Bodhi mind, Buddhas accomplish Anuttara Samyak Sambodhi, their highest perfect enlightenment. Okay, catch that. Because of sentient creatures, great compassion comes forth. What are sentient creatures like? Mostly hurting a lot. Being born, getting old, dying, coming back. Being born, getting old, dying. Over and over and over. That's the state of living beings, mostly. And in between, we struggle for profit, benefit. You know, try to find our way back home. You know, where's home? Well, I can't find it. You know, I'm just locked in this body. That's the state of living. Because the Buddha sees that, he goes, wow, gotta find a way to wake him up. You're home. You never left it. Come back. So because of living beings, great compassion comes forth. From great compassion comes the Bodhi mind. What is the Bodhi mind? That realization that my potential in my skin is great wisdom. Nothing less. Right? The Buddhas are not different from me in anything except resolve and effort. So the Bodhi mind, the Bodhi resolve, the Bodhicitta says, I can become completely wise and compassionate, and the way I do it is crossing over living beings, one by one by one, in my mind mostly. That's it. Say, ultimately to become a Buddha, immediately teaching living beings, waking living beings up. Because of the Bodhi mind, Buddhas accomplish equal and proper enlightenment. Then everybody's, this has been a long day, and I'm going to wind up real quick. So I see everybody's, lots of eyes are closing. Hang in there, we're almost done. So then it comes to this wonderful analogy of the king of trees out in the wilderness of birth. It could be Phoenix, Arizona. You know, this tree out there, you know, and it's growing in the rocks and sand of a barren wilderness. I mean, it could be Berkeley, California, for all of that, you know. So. When the roots get water, the branches, leaves flourish, and the flowers and fruits are abundant. So water the tree, and you get the flowers and fruits. Okay, the other side of the analogy. The regal Bodhi tree, likewise, is the same, growing in the wilderness of birth and death. In the wilderness of samsara, there's this Bodhi tree, which is to say, suffering can end. Right? You can walk the bodhisattva path. The regal Bodhi tree growing in the wilderness of samsara is the same. All living beings are its roots. Buddhas and bodhisattvas are its flowers and fruits. Same tree. Right? Living beings are the roots. The Buddhas are the flowers and the fruits. By benefiting living beings with the water of great compassion, service space, one can realize the flowers and fruits of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas' wisdom. Why is this? If Bodhisattvas benefit beings with the water of great compassion, they attain Anuttara Samyak Sambodhi, the highest enlightenment. Therefore, that's why I had it in red, Bodhi belongs to living beings. That's the key sentence in the entire sutra. Bodhi belongs to living beings. You want to get enlightened? Pay attention to living beings. Caves are great, but you got to come back out of the cave and start teaching if you really want to wake up. So, if there were no living beings, bodhisattvas could not achieve unsurpassed proper enlightenment. So what that means is, when you are there meditating, when you are there engaged in a service project, it's 3 a.m., you know you got to get up in the morning to get to work, you don't know how you're going to finish and get to work. Your kid is crying. Your kid will just is being a kid and is, you know. You say, right, this is the path to Bodhi. There is no other enlightenment other than doing the work, sticking to the middle way, getting some sleep, eating food, dealing with your kid. Thank you, kid, for being such a pain in the butt. You know, you're getting me to enlightenment quicker. You know, it's like, right? It's like, yeah. So it's like, when I read that passage of the sutra, it just goes, oh, yeah, that's really it. And you have to take your watch and put it in the drawer. You don't get there in a hurry. And what's the hurry? When are you going to become a Buddha? When living beings are, quote, crossed over, meaning awakened. When am I going to become a Buddha? When am I going to stop getting angry? That's the answer. Not before. There's no enlightenment around the anger. You gotta, you know. I don't want to tell a story. Too much explaining to do. Yesterday I got really angry. Oh. Tomorrow I gotta face it again and try not to get angry. So.
After a long, long time, you said.
Oh my God. So. Anyway, because I hadn't tried before. I'd been teaching school and things. Once you get back in the mix, the abundant chances to get angry. Yeah. And as Jayashpai says, samadhi, tell us the story. How's your samadhi? Samadhi is that concentration, that sense of stillness in the midst of the movement, serenity in the midst of the mix. So there you are. Anyway, so the bodhisattva path has a lot to do with that bodhicitta. And what we just read together is the actual teaching from the Buddha sutras about the Buddhist version. Now, there's a Catholic version of great compassion. There's a, you know, Vedanta version of great compassion. There's a Vipassana version. And we saw, you know, the Black Madonna sitting in Montserrat in Barcelona. And that's, I mean, you know that the Montserrat Monastery has, what do they say? It was an unbelievable number, something like 3 million individual visits per year of pilgrims who go up that mountain. 365 days, they get 350. Now they're including, you know, Montserrat, it's been the pilgrim place where you sent your plea. If you were a Catholic, you had, you know, grandma sick, and you send a message, please light a candle for us, because I live in Grenoble, and I live in Genoa, and you're in Spain. It's that Black Madonna is considered so powerful that people send in their prayers from all methods. Many messages in bottles get carried up the mountain. The bottle is tossed off an island somewhere and floats. And, oh, it's going to Montserrat. Take it up, you know. Light a candle, you know. So now, how do the messages come in?
Twitter
and email. They do indeed. They have an entire room dedicated to computers that do nothing but receive, please pray for us, and light a candle for us. True.
Did the amount of prayers increase?
Interestingly, there as they increase, the sincerity decrease. No, that's not true. It's people know they it was it's they all think it's a good thing, because it opened up an opportunity for people who would never get there otherwise, you know. So it's like we're so aware of the disasters now. It seems like the disasters are increasing, and it's probably only because we're wired now and we know about them. It's not that they weren't there. We just know about them now, you know. So it's not that the prayers weren't there. People just didn't get them. So there is an increase. There's 60 Benedictine monks full-time there who are there to greet the pilgrims, you know. So, anyway, there we are. Nipun, what was the story that you mentioned in the email?
I mentioned a bunch.
What the one that you wrote? I forget.
I got it. Francis, or the one of Manjushri, when...
This will be the last one, and then one more song and we're done. Maybe some time for questions. So, there were another two monks who did a three steps, one bow from Gold Mountain Monastery in San Francisco to Seattle. They were before myself and Marty. And so let me preface that by saying, I talked about bodhisattvas and how someone who is doing giving, holding precepts, practicing patience, being vigorous, entering state of samadhi and having wisdom, those are the bodhisattva's practices called the paramitas, the six paramitas. And bodhisattvas do that, and when we do it, we are emulating, we're on the path of bodhisattvas, we study bodhisattvas. But there are real bodhisattvas out there, and I gave you the celestial bodhisattvas, so you'll notice there's a tension there between these figures, devotional figures, Guan Yin Bodhisattva, the Blessed Virgin, and the bodhisattva that we want to become. So, will a real bodhisattva please stand up? You know, is Guan Yin really there, or is it me when I get, you know, it's like, you know, it's like there's this tension, kind of, yeah, both. Okay, and sometimes the bodhisattvas show up, all right? I mentioned Guan Yin Bodhisattva appears, sometimes in the sky like a light, and you go, wow, what's that? Other times, okay, so the first two monks, one of them was my college roommate, interestingly enough, and the man who brought me into the monastery, Bhikshu Hangyo. So he and Bhikshu Heng Chau were bowing from San Francisco to Marble Mount, Washington, and doing three steps, one bow. And they had a bad habit. The monk in the front, Heng Chau, had a bad habit, which was anytime he got sugar in his diet, he tended to get angry. You've seen kids space out on sugar, right? So he had that same thing. And Coke was the number one, Coca-Cola. People would offer Coca-Cola, and as soon as the Coca-Cola came from somebody to these monks, the monk in the back would go, oh boy, here it comes. And so sure enough, this is it, Master Hua, our teacher would say, you know, don't drink Coca-Cola, you know, don't get angry, you know. And so, okay, so they bowed up. They were like 3 miles from their destination, Marble Mount, Washington. And there was a roadside store. They were just, they'd been bowing, you know, 700 miles, and there was this roadside store. And they took a break by the side of the road. And the big monk, Heng Chau, the one in front, had been scolding the little monk, just really just picking on him. And, you know, monks are people too, and he hadn't. He had been an interesting story. He was a Navy submarine diver. He was a Navy SEAL. Tough guy. And yet he was, you know, trying to become a Buddhist monk. And he was bowing, bowing, bowing. So he scolded the young monk. The young monk's, he's a Pisces, and he gets in the Pisces blues a lot. So the big monk goes, wow, somebody had offered $1. So he went into the roadside store. And he's going to buy one bottle of Coke, not one only, not two, because he's. So he's in there, and he goes in, and he feels right away, this is not right. What am I doing here? I'm supposed to be the bowing monk, right? I'm in here buying a Coke, you know. He feels kind of funny, and he thinks, and the storekeepers, how are you doing? You know, it's, yeah, watch you guys out there. Good luck. You know? And so this pickup truck pulls up. Pulls up. This guy gets out with two dogs. And the dogs are running all over the place. And the guy comes in, and he's got big, bushy eyebrows, and kind of hard to tell. Nobody could remember exactly how tall he was, but some people saw him taller. And what they did notice was when he came in, there was this electrical energy. Just everybody kind of went, you know, picked up a little bit. And he seemed to know everybody in the store. How you doing? Hey! Nice to see you. Yeah. Hey, looking good. And he had dark glasses on. Nice to see you. Wow, okay. And so the monk, Heng Chau, immediately thought, I've got to get back bowing. I've got to get out of here. So he looked, and here was the guy on this aisle. So he thought, I'll go in this aisle. He went in this aisle. The guy shifted to the aisle. So he goes, you know, Heng Chau turns around and kind of backs out. And he bumps right up against this guy. Suddenly he's very tall. He takes his glasses off and he says, do you call yourself a Buddhist? Looking right at Heng Chau. Heng Chau's 6'2". You know, he's going, well, I never said I was perfect. Immediately defensive. You know, and the guy says, would you like to hear what the Buddha taught in plain English? He said, the Buddha taught compassion. Quit knocking the other guy around. That's the Buddha's message. Anyway, see you later, fellas. Jump in the truck. And the dog jumped in the truck, and he's gone. Heng Chau's in there going, you know, and he goes out to the other monk. He forgets the Coke. He goes out and he sees the other monk sitting on the curb. You know, it's like, got 3 miles to go. Let's go. And the monk says, no. He says, I really want to apologize to you. He says, I've been really bad to you. It's not right. Okay, you ready? Let's go. So they bow, finish 3 miles. They bow really fast. And so they finished, and they turn around, And there was this giant cloud stretching from as far as they could see over Mount Rainier, a dragon-shaped cloud. And so the other monk said, you know, I think we better call the master. Let's call Sherfu. So they get on the phone, and they, Sherfu, did you finish? Says Master Hua. Bai Wa Lama, he says. And they say, yeah, we finished, Sherfu. But there was this funny thing that happened, Sherfu, this guy. Tell me on, what's the story? So they tell Heng Ju, and Heng Yo didn't know anything about this, you know. So he says, this guy came into the store, Sherfu, and he was like, he had two little dogs, and he was like really big, and he looked right at me, and he knew every thought I was in my head, you know, Sherfu. And he taught me, what did he say? He said, the Buddha taught compassion, I gotta stop knocking the other guy around. Sherfu says, did you bow to him? No, Sherfu, I didn't even bow. Idiot! Manjushri Bodhisattva comes all the way out to teach you, you don't even know to bow to him. Manjushri Bodhisattva? He says, never mind. He says, you made it. He said, well, stay there, we'll come up tomorrow, you know. So it's like they're looking at each other and they're going, and Sherpa, there was a dragon cloud. And Sherpa says, of course there was a dragon cloud. Manjushri Bodhisattva is followed by, you said you thought those were dogs, those were lions. Manjushri always had two lions around. So it's like, you go, oh my God. Okay, so, and then Master Hua Saban, he said, it doesn't really matter. He says, you finished. He says, the fact that Manjushri came out to teach you, he said, the clear sequential description of where great compassion comes from. And it says, you know, because of living beings, there's great compassion. Because you witness how confused we are, mostly. You know, we're still eating other creatures. You know, and thinking that the more protein we get in our bodies, the better, and that the best protein comes from animal flesh. Never mind that the animal didn't get a boat, you know, didn't get to, you know, that's confusion. And it's pervasive, you know. We were talking about how hard it is to get a vegetarian restaurant going in Berkeley, California. You have to add fish or meat. Karma Kitchen notwithstanding, that's once a week. So how come vegetarian restaurants don't survive in Berkeley? Since I've been there, I've watched the closing of a dozen of them, you know? And it's because we're attached to our karma. Our karma is so heavy we can't stop eating and being eaten in return. So how sad. You know, and that's why there's great compassion. You think, boy, I'd sure like to wake people up. You know, because of that, you say, how do I do that? Well, I have to become wise and compassionate. I'd like to become a Buddha, so I'll start by vowing to take living beings across. You know, that's the Bodhisattva's vows. So Bodhisattvas do this impossible thing. Even though living beings are numberless, I vow to save them all. Even though afflictions are endless, I vow to cut them all off. Even though methods of practice are boundless, I vow to learn them all. Even though the Buddha's path is the highest endeavor, I vow to master. So, there's where it shows up. That's the long answer.
We have several
questions.
Oh, you do? Okay. Good. George, did you have your hand up?
No, I was.
Sir, Reverend Heng Sure, in your journey of the three steps in the bow, is there a particular experience or an insight that stayed with you that you can share with us?
I wrote 9 volumes. So, yes.
Of those, what stood out most?
Yeah. Oh, it's hard to say one, but Ashish, you can point to a time when we reached the city of 10,000 Buddhas after 2 years and 6 months and 800 miles now. But the pilgrimage is still going on. So it's, you know, I wouldn't try to limit it to that time. It's ongoing. There's lots of dramatic. Well, I'll tell you one. Okay, here you go. I got one. And this actually came up as something I thought I might talk about, but thank you for mentioning. I had asked Josh Bai about fear, because I was amazed at what he does in the movie that we saw, you know. And people wanting him dead, and, you know, threatening to kill him. And how do you come up with the courage? Or just how do you overcome fear? And it's something that I'm sure many of us encounter on a daily basis. How do you deal with fear? And fear is, and you just drive a car on 101 at 5 p.m. It's just a frightening experience. So during the pilgrimage, there's a place called Paso Robles. Paso Robles. And there are long stretches of road that are nothing, this pasture, cow pasture, and farmland. It's really good farmland. And there's a high school, and because the two monks go 1 mile a day, we're visible for a long time. And so the kids in their pickup trucks got to see us coming, approaching, passing through, and leaving. And it became a sport for some of the more adventurous ones to run their pickup trucks at us, to play chicken and see how close they could get as we bowed on the ground. And it was scary, you know, because every day about 4 o'clock when high school lets out, we go, here they go. Pebbles and dust covering it. We spent a lot of evenings in laundromats because our ropes were just covered in dust and pebbles, you know, squirting out of tires, and they would come that close, playing chicken. And it's kids. You know, like we were slow-moving targets, sitting ducks. We were sitting monks, bowing monks, not sitting ducks. So it's like I got to the place where I was going, come on, Guanyin Bodhisattva, bash their heads in, come on. Bring out your, I was reciting the Great Compassion Mantra like a weapon. Namo halada no. Get him. wrong. Red line. Wrong. And so, but it got, I mean, because they were like, every day, it got to be, I was thinking, you know, geez, what if one of them had something to drink before? Like, and so, gee, Guanyin Bodhisattva, protect us. You know, it's like, in my mind, it was enemy time, you know. So, one day, we got into the town, passing through, and it was the end, we needed water. And we had like 4 plastic gallon water, you know, milk containers we used as water jugs, and go to gas stations and fill them up at the water pump. So we were in the gas station, actually parked in a grocery store parking lot, and Marty took the empty bottles and went over to the gas station and to fill them up. And guess who pulled in beside us? 3 pickup trucks with the guys, with the kids. And there, suddenly I had faces on them. And it was like, that's okay. This is South Island of New Zealand. I was just, that's a helicopter I was shooting from.
Mount Cook.
No, not really. Yes, it is Mount Cook, as a matter of fact. Yeah, this is Lake Wakatipu. And anyway, so never mind. Nice place. So anyway, so here were these kids. They pulled up in their park, their pickup trucks, and there they were. And they're like doing what teenage boys do when you know, looking for girls, you know, daring each other to smoke and stuff. And so I'm kind of like slinking down in my seat. I hope they don't see me. What if they come over and beat me up, you know? And it's like, I'm really starting to sweat it, you know? So then in the rearview mirror, I see a figure. First I notice the color, a golden robe, precept robe, looking very much like mine. Fills the rearview mirror, and I'm turning around, and here's Master Hua, here's my teacher, from San Francisco, which is, you know, 400 miles north. And he walks right past, and I think, he walks right by me, goes right over to the pickup trucks, leans his arms down on the pickup truck and says, how are you doing? Hello, nice to see you. finished with school? You know? And these teenage guys are going, yeah? Yeah? Who are you? Hi, nice. I'm watching. Pretty soon they're having a great time at the picnic, and Master Hua's leaning on the truck and talking to them, and like, you know, and they're laughing, and he asks them what they're studying. He starts to teach them Chinese characters, and they're, you know, they offer him a drink, and he offers them some candy, and they're, and I'm sitting in the car, and I'm just getting smaller and smaller. And the kids turn into teenage boys. They're not enemies. They're not evil. They're not killers. They're teenage boys. And he completely tames them. In 5 minutes, they're best friends. And he goes, okay, so long. And one of them goes, hasta la vista, padre. You know, yeah. So, and he comes over to my car window, and he looks and he says to me in English, don't you feel ashamed? Don't use the Great Compassion mantra as a weapon. He says, it means great compassion. Your heart is too small. He said. It's like, how did he know? How did he show up? Right in the nick of time, you know? And he just uses his heart. These kids are kids. They're doing what boys do, you know? And it's like, I'll never forget that. So a wholesome dharma from a heart of fear and self becomes an unwholesome dharma. Come on, Guanyin, bash their heads, you know? No. And, you know, so that's what a Kalyana Mitra does, what a good advisor, so. Anyway, that's one of many. Aren't you ashamed of yourself? Yeah. So, anyway, it's been a long day, I'm sure.
Longer for you. Last question, can you speak a little bit about skillful means? And because a lot of the questions and issues that come up now for service space are, it's not just black and white anymore, you know, because of the scale at which we're operating. So there's always edges. I don't know how, what would a bodhisattva say, but what, you know, how would,
give an example.
Some, like technology, you know, there's on one side, a bodhisattva says, oh, you want to reach all living beings. Mm. And if the living beings are using, you know, Twitter and Facebook, you want to go there. On the other hand, it propagates, cycles that,
yeah,
may or may not be wholesome, and so do you, you know, there's a lot, yeah, of response, and there's, and like that, there's so many edges, and so I've learned that skillful means is a very big part of this process, and so what would you say to, how do, yeah, you, what is skillful means?
Yeah, yeah. Okay, the question is upaya, and the, it means skill and means, expedience, things that, that you teach according to the individual person, the time, and the place. That's what's when it's expedient. So a different time, a different person, a different place, use a different method. So that's what makes it expedient, means it's not an ultimate, you're teaching something ultimate using something temporal, temporary. So it's a means, it's a method, a technique. It's the map, not the journey. But without the map, you go wrong. If you don't walk, it's only a map. So you need a method. Some methods are more skillful than others. How do you ultimately decide what's a skillful and clever, expedient means is determined by your wisdom. That's the rub. Sorry. So how skillful the expedient will be depends on the depth of your wisdom, your insight. You're seeing past the surface. So if you can see past the surface of any situation and say, you know, ultimately the heart of it is here, so I'm going to come up with a skillful means to move people closer to awakening. That's a skillful, expedient means. You'll know if it was skillful when it works. And you may not know whether it worked for a while. Here's an example. A young man came into the monastery, and he was he's a political activist. He's Jewish, and he's toying with the idea of becoming a monk, right? And this guy he's a Berkeley guy. His name is Mo, and Berkeley, and Mo is he's fearless, but fearless in the wrong way. He's like he doesn't fear embarrassing himself in any situation. So he's there talking after the lecture, and Master Hua, the teacher, says, "Anybody have a question?" And so Mo says, "I'd like you to tell me why I should leave home." You know, kind of Three Stooges, kind of yunk, yunk, yunk. You know, let's see the teacher handle this one. You know,
leaving home means
to become a monk. Yeah, yeah. And so Master Hua smiles and says, "Well, if you leave home, you have the potential to become compassionate and wise, and you would know exactly the right thing to say to your father to get him to stop killing animals." Mm-hmm. Mo goes, "I'll think about it," he said. And we're going, "That's funny." So we ask him afterwards, "Why did you, you know, it totally changed him. It just, bang, hit him, bang, across the head." And he said, "My dad's a kosher butcher. The one thing in the world that I want most is to get him to stop that." How did he know? And he left home. He became a monk. Wow. Yeah, yeah. There's a skill, you know, and it was just the right word. I mean, he could have said anything, but he said, "When you become a monk, you have the potential to be wise enough to say exactly the right thing to get your father to give up his, you know." So that's a skillful, but he could see through the surface. I'm assuming, I don't know how he did that, but he saw past the surface. So you look at the surface and you say, what's the heart of it? What's the potential? If by saying, "I'm posting a story of goodness online to subscribers every day, I might change minds, I might wake people up a little bit and make them a better day," you know, think, yeah, that's a skillful, expedient means, because it's not there otherwise. And by the response, by the, you know, the comments that you get from Daily Good, you know that that's a skillful means. So until you have real wisdom, you don't know. So you don't stop, but you figure you're going to miss a couple. So you go out and try it. If you're hitting 51%, you're doing good. Okay. Should we do...
closing comment? Rob, did you have any closing comments?
Oh, no. Just thank you.
Oh.
Thank you very
much. Where's the book? Through me, but not from me, but with my wishes inscribed, let me, on behalf of Service Space, offer you this.
Thank you very much.
I think you've touched many hearts with your generosity. Take a look. Do you all know what this is?
Prince Siddhartha? Is that possible?
The illustrated history, the illustrated life of the Buddha.
Wonderful.
It's pictures by the artist whose name is Sharma, right? Incredible photographs or paintings of the Buddha's life. So, what was the book on your desk that they saw?
Dogo Kiensei, 37 verses or 37. 14 years old, small village in Nova Scotia, Canada. A lot of poverty, a lot of suffering. No running water.
15 suicidal, a couple of attempts, 17 arrested for selling drugs, 18 in prison, 19 got exposed to the idea that maybe I had a problem with living, and that maybe it wasn't such a good idea to take drugs every day and to drink every day and to be trying to kill myself. So it started on the road of, you know, maybe there's some other way to live besides this. And on my 28th birthday, I finally hit a bottom, and I ended up in a detox, and I surrendered. Someone mentioned surrender earlier. You know, I had a really good surrender, and I was in this room in the detox the first few hours, and I had arrived with some drugs, prescribed drugs that were supposed to be taken as needed. And this was a turning point for me in a lot of ways, but I told the nurse that, you know, it said as needed on the bottle, and therefore, you know, keep them coming fairly frequently. they'll be needed. And she looked at me and she said, you need to experience the withdrawals from this, and you're okay. You know, your blood pressure's okay. You don't need to take any more sedatives. And I was in shock, you know. And anyway, long story short, I got my clothes on and I was going to leave. And the nurse walked back in and she said, are you going somewhere? And I said, yeah, I'm leaving. And she said, oh, that's too bad, but goodbye. And I was shocked again because she didn't try to stop me. And I surrendered again. And that was 27 or 28 years ago. And that's the last time I used drugs. So that was the beginning of a new life for me, you know. And I started working on myself. And about 10 or 12 years ago, I got into Buddhism and started to meditate and study hard, and my life really started to change then. And you know, my life's been a series of miracles. I had no education. I had never worked more than 3 months in my life. I'd been homeless at times. And you know, I got clean and sober, which really needed to happen. And once that happened, you know, the spiritual growth started to slowly happen, but I had no clue how to live whatsoever. First thing I did was start a company with $400 recycling clothing. And 3 years later, there were 50 employees. And 25 years later, it's still going. And there's 50 people working there. And you know, I did a bunch of other things, but really at this stage of my life, I'm also called just to try and regear my life more towards service. And that's why when I got the call from Tavi, you know, I trust these, like nothing happens by mistake. I live, nothing happens by mistake. This property was not in my plan. You know, it was in some higher plan, and I looked for 7 months and tried to buy all kinds of different properties here. And none of them worked out, and I just surrendered. It was okay that they didn't work out, but finally I was led here way beyond my means to buy this property, way beyond. And the people helped me buy it that owned it. You know, just it all fell together. And I prayed at that time and said, you know, whatever you want me to use this for, I'm willing to use it. It's not mine, it's yours, you know. And so that's why when Patty called, it's like, yeah, thank you. You know? So, you know, you're thanking me, but really, in my heart, I'm thanking you guys for giving this meaning, this place, the sacred space that it is, and manifesting, you know, meaning into this sacred space. And so I'm really, really blessed, right? So I live a lot of miracles every day, and when I go to sleep at night, just before I go to sleep, I thank God, or, you know, Buddha, or whatever you want to call it, for my pillow, you know, just for a pillow, just for a safe place to sleep. So I don't have any, let's say, I don't take credit for what's manifesting. It's just, you know, it just is, right? And I'm blown away by the whole thing myself. I'm constantly blown away. So Yeah, and service is where it's at, and you guys are amazing, and I'm just honored to meet each and every one of you, and I'm grateful that you're here. I truly am. So that's it. Short version.
Thank you. I think it would be appropriate to do a dedication of merit to Rob.
It's not a small thing at all, and it really ripples out, as so much of what service space is about is just starting the tossing the pebble in the pond and watching the ripples grow. So this dedication of merit is exactly that. You use your mind to send out the energy, and you say, all of the goodness that I've created and shared today, I would like to give to, and you fill in the blank, to all living beings, to my grandmother, to beings yet to come, with the wish that, you fill in the blank, whatever you'd like to do. And when we do it together, it gets real strength. This, think of a radio broadcast tower sending out that signal in all directions at once to whoever can, whoever has the radio to pick it up. So the mind is probably the strongest thing in the world, and when it's focused and concentrated in a wish for goodness, then goodness can result. So please make a wish. It's your wish, however you'd like to do it. Before we finish, I would be remiss if I didn't introduce you. Who? I don't know, I keep asking myself. Who? Who? Who's in there? I don't know, sometimes he's happy, sometimes he's angry. Who? I'm wondering.
Keep looking. Investigate. Who?
Yeah. Who? Who?
Who?
Thank you. Be quiet.
Who?
I know. This is my Zen owl.
Who?
Oh, there he is. There you go.
sit up.
Okay. There we go. Ah, right there. Ah.